be back when they were the Millennium Development Goals. We missed that target, and I'm really hoping that we can hit the next one. You know, as many of you probably know, they're an urgent call for action that demand our responses rooted in the spirit of our collective humanity. And if we're going to create a world that's more just, peaceful, and equitable, all individuals and societies need to work together to build knowledge and skills and values. So I feel like this is the full domain. So I just recently finished my major research project for my Master's of Education. And so I will just share briefly, this was the output of it, because I did look at an open scholarly community and how policy development for the policy recommendations of UNESCO can get implemented. And I'm going to reframe this with some examples and some of the work that I've done, particularly about open science. And so in particular, when you have the UNESCO policy recommendation, that's the design space. And then if you look down to the member states, and, you know, and then you look at the country and the provinces and the universities, when it comes to policy implementation, it's really, you know, the work of tenure-tracked faculty. And so I was really interested in what would be required for tenure-track faculty at the institutional level who actually have to implement policy, what that would look like. And so this idea of upstream and downstream. And so I looked at that in particular, and I just want to kind of make a pitch for what that looks like. So we know that often faculty are closely connected to their disciplinary communities than actually within an institution. And so your disciplinary networks are really what set your scholarly goals. So how can we have a value alignment at the institutional level so that these disciplinary networks are in alignment? And so I looked in particular, the standard workload agreement in most Canadian universities, you know, is this 40% research, 40% teaching, and 20% service, although we know that it's often 100%, 100%, 100%, that you spend a great deal of time doing all of these things. And I just wanted to highlight the breadth of what open science means across of the teaching, research, and service spectrum for faculty, and how it, and just give some examples of that and talk a little bit about it. So in the research process, we're seeing a colonization of what should be an open process. This is an example from Leslie Chan and his colleagues looking at how Elsevier has like colonized this entire process. And as this is a drawing that I did for Leslie in one of his keynotes, where this is just not a healthy ecosystem. And it's actually encouraging epistemic exclusion is what he calls it, but it's really not, it's not allowing different types of knowledge into this this system that is actually driven by ideological and political and economic drivers, which are rooted in colonialism and capitalism, and they're acting as gatekeepers to knowledge. And so what can open science do to open that up? So open access is one of the areas, although we're also seeing commercial publishers co-opting open access and charging exorbitant fees in order to publish. But it's not just about the content that is being put out there being made available. It's actually much broader than that. So we've seen it most recently, the COVID-19 vaccination that is coming out is not just like we allowed rapid sharing of information for this to happen, but the data, molecules, and genetic sequences has actually been made available because of people sharing their data over an extended period of time. And some of these drawings are actually from Dr. Elad Edwards, which Dr. Nekova mentioned earlier when Shasta was talking about him. So this is one of his talks that I took. I've mashed it up a little bit. I just want to reiterate, these are all Creative Commons. You can use them as you wish. And another great example that Dr. Edwards talks about is the AlphaFold success, where we're able to take you know, by looking at DNA, now this machine learning, the deep learning can actually figure out what the protein structures look like. But this didn't happen by accident. This is like 50 years of sharing data into repositories so that there was enough data for this AI, artificial intelligence, to actually analyze and be able to do output. So it requires collaboration on a massive scale to solve these complex problems. And this is just like STEM based, but I wanted to look, oh yeah, there's a great op-ed that I wanted to share that Dr. Edwards also wrote about how open science for the public good is actually necessary in order for us to advance. We need to start looking forward into what that looks like. And so I feel like this is actually hugely critical at this juncture, not just because of the pandemic, but because of our ongoing climate crisis and massive inequities. Another person is Kathleen Fitzpatrick, who talks about open sustainable research communities. So this isn't just science, technology, engineering, and math. This is humanities and social science as well, can have these open infrastructures for sharing their preprints, and they can connect to institutional repositories so that there's not a duplication of interest. So there's these are all open source tools and processes that can promote public good. So this is another project called Public Funding, Public Code, where if you're going to use public funds to build something, then it should be also made available. So get back to the points I've been made earlier about how important open source and open infrastructure is. And there's just a graphic that I've to drive home that point. Something that is near and dear to me and a couple other people in here as well, I know, are open educational resources. And I put a little link in there because we do know that funding can help push processes, and the Ontario government has just announced after a long wait that there will be some public funding available for open educational resource development, which is really exciting, just came out this week. So this is teaching, learning, and research materials. I don't feel like it's just teaching, but it's and it really does transform access and affordability for students. There's no sense in having a $300 textbook when really, a first year biology is pretty standard. We kind of know the key things, and you don't need to reinvent the wheel each time. And you do have this option of building upon it as well. But I did want to talk a little bit about, and this isn't part of the open science, but this is actually an important aspect of open educational resources, is actually OER as content, where the students are becoming to create open educational material themselves. And so it's open educational practices. This could fit into what open science calls citizen science, where, whether you're counting birds or doing field work. And a lot of the stuff that I love was Dr. Longboat was saying about holding the snakes, being in nature and actually adding to, either you're looking at weather patterns. So citizen science is a whole spectrum, or it could be, editing Wikipedia and just putting in irrelevant information. So assessments don't need to be just putting out a test and then did I tell you the information? Do you know it? It can actually be that students are adding value to the world. And this is the kind of work that I would love to see more happen. And so that brings us to decolonizing knowledge that Dr. Longboat talked about wonderfully and beautifully. But I did want to talk a little bit about how, reducing those power structures in the teaching environment is something that is important, and also in our research process. This is from a talk I did in Saskatchewan from the VP of Indigenous there. And, it was just some really interesting insights about how we can shift the hierarchical structures that we are so bound to at institutions. This is some work that I did at the Knowledge Equity Lab, which was referenced earlier, and there's a link there that you can talk about the video. And so it's really, again, this shift of talking about how so much of research development and resources go to Western Europe and North America, and the rest of the world is actually left within North America, or Indigenous communities are kind of left out of the conversation, and how important land-based knowledge is, oral language tradition, which has been mentioned before, and approaching this from intersectional, so that we're looking at it from a feminist equity lens. And so it's not just about access, making things available. There's actually three prongs to this. It's so for whom? I want to make it available for the world. I'm going to create a material and make it available. But it's also important about whom. What are you writing about? Who are you writing about? And most importantly is by whom, is allowing these other voices. So on the right here is that scholarship. And so only certain people are allowed onto that boat, but are we allowing other lived experiences and voices to come forward? And I think that's a really important part of the voice that the response for open science was brought. And so if we look at the iterative policy design, there shouldn't really be upstream and downstream, it needs to be iterative and cyclical. And that's why things like this are so essential, that we can have this opportunity to really talk about our response to the UNESCO policy and what we think that can be done, because ultimately at the end of the day, it gets implemented downstream at our level at the institution. But if it's so far removed from the design, we need to make sure that we're feeding back into that cyclical thing. And with that, I will hand it back so that we can have a really rich conversation.
Thank you so much.